Invertebrates are animals without backbones. They have no internal bony skeletons for support. Some have external skeletons. Others are supported by the pressure of fluids in their bodies, called a hydrostatic skeleton. Some invertebrates have no skeleton at all and depend on the support of a watery medium. The simplest invertebrates are the sponges. They range from creeping forms about a centimeter high to large structures over a meter tall. Sponges grow attached to rocks or other substrates by an adhesive base. Tiny pores scattered over the surface of the sponge lead to the central cavity. These pores give the sponge phylum its name, Porifera. Sponges draw water currents in through the pores. The water leaves through an opening at the top of the sponge. Cells lining the body cavity extract food and oxygen from the water. The sponge's body is supported by spicules of silica, calcium carbonate, or protein. The simplest animals with an organized body structure are the coelenterates, the anemone group. The coelenterates, or cnidaria, have radial symmetry. You can draw an imaginary line through the center of the body in several different planes. The body on one side of the line will be a mirror image of the other side. The basic coelenterate body plan is a cup surrounded by tentacles. There are two forms. In the polyp form, the base of the cup is attached to the substrate and the mouth faces up. The medusa form is found in jellyfish. The whole animal swims free in the water by contracting the inverted cup, now called a bell. Some coelenterates form colonies. Individual polyps are connected to each other at the base. Corals and hydroids are colonies of polyps. The coelenterate body wall is made up of two layers, an outer layer, or ectoderm, and an inner layer, or endoderm. A jelly-like substance separates the two. On the tentacles, there are stinging cells which shoot barbed threads into any passing water creature which touches them, capturing and paralyzing it. Food enters and waste products leave through the mouth, the only opening. The name of the phylum Platyhelminths means flatworms. The flat body has bilateral or two-sided symmetry. Only one plane can divide the body into mirror image halves. Most animals have bilateral symmetry. Flatworms also have a distinct front end, the anterior end, and a rear end, the posterior end. There's an upper surface, the dorsal side, and a lower surface, the ventral side. Flatworms have a three-layered body. In between the ectoderm and endoderm is a third layer of tissue, the mesoderm. The platyhelminths include several groups of parasites. Tapeworms live in the guts of other animals. They have long, ribbon-like bodies divided into compartments. Hooks on the head anchor them to their host's gut wall. The flukes include both external and internal parasites, which cling to their hosts by suckers. Roundworms belong to the phylum Nematoda. Nematoda means thread-like. Roundworms may be the most numerous invertebrates on Earth. They're found in almost every habitat. Many are parasites in plants and animals. 1 cubic meter of soil can contain up to 10 million roundworms. Segmented worms belong to the phylum Annelida. They're more highly organized than flatworms and roundworms. The name annelid means ringed. The rings correspond to body segments, individual compartments separated by partitions called septa. Each segment has its own muscles, gut, blood vessels, and excretory organs. Individual segments may be specialized for particular functions. There's a fluid-filled body cavity sandwiched between layers of mesoderm. Sheets of mesoderm tissue support the gut and hold other body organs in place in this cavity. Such a body cavity is called a coelome. The rest of the animals we'll look at have coelomes. There are three main groups of annelids. The oligocheta have relatively few bristles or cheti. The polychetes have many more bristles, carried on fleshy stubs called parapodia. Polychetes include the ragworms, the burrowing lugworms or sandworms, the sea mouse, and the tube worms. The third group of annelids is the hirudinia, the leeches. Leeches are parasites on many animals. They cling to their host by a big sucker at the mouth end and feed on the host's blood. The largest group of animals with segmented bodies are the arthropods, 80% of all the species of animals in the world. Arthropods are covered in a hard outer layer, an exoskeleton, or cuticle. This protects the arthropod and provides a firm base for attaching muscles. The name arthropod means jointed leg. The cuticle is made up of a series of plates joined by thinner, flexible membranes. The legs and other appendages are jointed. Each joint can move in only one plane, but with several joints operating in different planes, many different movements are possible. The cuticle can't stretch to allow for growth. From time to time, it's shed, and a new, larger cuticle grows in its place. This is called molting. At this time, the animal is soft and vulnerable. The weight of the cuticle also limits the size of an arthropod. It could become too heavy to move. Arthropods have many different kinds of appendages. Some form paddles for swimming, antennae, and complicated mouthparts. The largest group is the insects. The insect body is divided into three parts: the abdomen, the thorax, and the head. The head of the adult insect has one pair of antennae and a pair of compound eyes. Three pairs of legs are attached to the thorax. Many adult insects also have one or two pairs of wings attached to the thorax. One pair may take the form of hard wing cases to protect the larger, more delicate pair below. The arachnids have only two main parts of the body, the cephalothorax, which includes the head and thorax, and the abdomen. They have four pairs of walking legs on the cephalothorax and no antennae. Their eyes are small and simple. Arachnids include spiders, scorpions, ticks, and mites. The crustacea have two pairs of antennae and three pairs of mouthparts on the head. They have five or more pairs of legs. The front pair of legs is often larger than the others. They're used as pincers to handle food. The larger crustaceans often strengthen their shells with calcium carbonate and can become quite heavy. In many crustaceans, such as crabs and lobsters, the segments of the head and thorax are fused to form a heavy plate, the carapace. Centipedes belong to the class Chylopoda. They have only one pair of legs on each segment. The first pair is armed with poison claws, used to catch small soil animals. Millipedes belong to the class Diplopoda. They have two pairs of legs on each segment. Most millipedes are herbivorous. Millipedes and centipedes are sometimes classed together as the Myriapoda, or animals with many feet. Arthropods may have evolved from annelids. Both have segmented bodies, but the segments of arthropods are much more specialized. One little animal found in the tropics, Peripatus, has been suggested as a possible intermediate between arthropods and annelids. It has a soft, worm-like body, and its feet are on stubby legs, rather like the parapodia of ragworms. It has antennae, like the arthropods, and an exoskeleton of chitin. In fact, it's rather like a cross between an annelid worm and an arthropod caterpillar. The phylum Mollusca contains over 100,000 species. The name mollusk means soft-bodied. The mollusk body consists of a well-developed head joined directly to a muscular structure called the foot. Most of the body organs, the viscera, are found in a hump of tissue called the visceral hump, which rises from the foot. The visceral hump is covered by a cloak of tissue called the mantle, which extends over the head and foot to form the mantle cavity. In many mollusks, the mantle secretes a shell of calcium carbonate. In snails, the visceral hump and shell are twisted into a spiral. The biggest group of mollusks is the gastropods, the snails, slugs, and sea slugs. There are two pairs of tentacles on the head. The longest tentacles bear the eyes. In slugs, the shell is greatly reduced and is buried in the mantle. The limpets have simple shells that do not coil. Bivalves have a pair of shells hinged in the middle. The foot is usually withdrawn inside the shell. Cephalopods include squid, octopus and cuttlefish. They have very large heads and a foot divided into 8 or 10 tentacles equipped with suckers. Mollusks may be related to annelids. Both groups have characteristic swimming larvae called trochophores. Echinoderms, or spiny-skinned animals, are covered in an exoskeleton of spines and plates of hard calcium carbonate. Adult echinoderms have radial symmetry, like the coelenterates, but their larvae are bilateral. For this reason, echinoderms are probably not closely related to coelenterates. The body parts are arranged in fives, or multiples of five. Echinoderms move by means of tube feet, tiny fluid-filled bags that can be extended and retracted by changes in water pressure. The echinoderms include the starfish, brittle stars, sea urchins, sea cucumbers, and feather stars. Sea squirts belong to the phylum Chordata, the same phylum as the vertebrates. The tadpole-like larva has a segmented strengthening rod in its tail. The rod, called a notochord, disappears in the adult sea squirt. The adult is a bag-like filter feeder with two siphons to let water in and out. Vertebrate larvae, or embryos, also have a notochord. In adult vertebrates, the notochord develops into the spinal column. Another invertebrate, Amphioxus, retains its notochord throughout life. The notochord suggests a common ancestor for sea squirts, Amphioxus, and vertebrates. Some animals get food and oxygen by moving through the environment. Sedentary animals rely on the environment to carry food and oxygen to them. Some, like sponges, move the environment through their bodies. Tiny filaments in the body cavity filter out organic matter. Oxygen diffuses into the cells. Coelenterates absorb oxygen through the whole body surface. Coelenterates trap prey on stinging tentacles and push it into the mouth. Digestive enzymes secreted into the body cavity break down the food into a thick soup. Nutrients pass round the body by simple diffusion. The undigested remains are ejected through the mouth. Flatworms, roundworms, and most annelids have a muscular tube-like mouth. Annelids like this earthworm have a gut where food is digested by enzymes. They also have a blood circulation system that transports digested food around the body. Leeches suck blood and body fluids. They have sharp, saw-like jaws made of chitin. The leech injects chemicals that anaesthetize the skin and prevent blood coagulation. Arthropods probably have the most varied diets and mouthparts in the animal kingdom. Their mouthparts are made of chitin, a material so hard that some beetles and their larvae can feed on wood. Serrated, biting mouthparts can chew tough plant fibers. Grasshoppers, locusts, and caterpillars feed this way. Other insects use sharp mouthparts to pierce skin and flesh. Butterflies, bees, and many bugs feed on liquid food, nectar, and plant sap by sucking it up through a tube-like proboscis. Butterflies have very long proboscises. They can roll them up out of the way when they're not feeding. Spiders and flies secrete digestive enzymes into their food, liquefying it before they suck it up. Crabs, shrimps and lobsters pick up their food with pincers on their front legs and pass it to the mouth. The pincers are armed with rows of chalky teeth. Snails and slugs rasp plant material, rotting vegetation and corals. They have a tongue-shaped scraper in their mouth, armed with tiny horny teeth. This is called the radula. Sea urchins use plate-like teeth to rasp corals and algae. Brittle stars and starfish grip their prey with their tube feet. A starfish can pull hard enough to open up a muscle. The starfish turns its stomach inside out so that it surrounds the food. It secretes digestive enzymes until the prey becomes soup-like. Cephalopods seize prey with suckers on their tentacles and push it into the mouth. Many invertebrates filter food directly from the water. Some use rows of bristles along their legs to trap particles of organic material. Barnacles virtually lie on their backs and kick food into their mouths. Tube worms trap food with their whorls of feathery tentacles. Like sponges, bivalves draw water through their bodies instead of moving their filters through the water. Their filters are internal. Plumose anemones and feather stars are covered in streaming mucus, which carries trapped food particles to the mouth. More complex invertebrates, such as arthropods and annelids, have blood vascular systems to transport food and oxygen. Diffusion is not adequate when bodies become larger and complex. Annelids take in oxygen by diffusion as the blood passes close to the body surface. Some animals have special organs for obtaining oxygen. Aquatic invertebrates have gills. Gills have a large surface area, rich in blood capillaries, where oxygen diffuses from the water to the blood. Most mollusks have gills in their mantle cavities. In terrestrial snails and slugs, the moist lining of the mantle cavity acts as an air-breathing lung. Most crustaceans have feathery gills under their carapace. Movements of the limbs circulate water over the gills. Terrestrial arthropods use air instead of water as oxygen source. Insects have a series of tiny holes called spiracles along their sides. These are linked to a branching network of tubes, the tracheae and tracheoles, that carry oxygen to all parts of the body. Body movements help to circulate the air. Invertebrates that have mechanisms for circulating food and oxygen around the body can become large and complex. How an animal moves depends on how big it is, what kind of skeleton it has, and whether it's in air, water, or on land. Coelenterates bend their bodies and tentacles by relaxing and contracting muscles in the body wall. Jellyfish swim through the water by contracting their bell. This pushes a jet of water out of the bell. Cephalopods use a similar kind of jet propulsion. And so do scallops. Snails, slugs, and flatworms move by waves of muscular contractions that pass along the underside of the body. These push the animal forward, lubricated by a layer of mucus. Some marine flatworms swim by undulating the whole body. Some mollusks use the muscular foot for burrowing. Annelids have a hydrostatic skeleton. The body of the worm is filled with fluid against which the muscles push. The division of the body into segments gives the worm more control over its movements. Waves of muscle contraction pass along the worm's body. The worm uses bristles or chitin on its ventral surface to anchor parts of its body to the ground, while other parts are extended forward. Some annelids use their parapodia for locomotion. Echinoderms also have a hydrostatic skeleton, which extends into the muscular tube feet. Arthropods use jointed appendages to walk, run, jump, fly, and swim. Arthropods have peg and socket joints. Muscles arranged in opposing pairs are attached to pegs on the inside of the skeleton. Many insects have one or two pairs of wings attached to the thorax. The wings flex as they beat, pushing the air back and down. In some insects, the wings are linked by tiny hooks, and both pairs act together. Animals that move need to be able to see where they're going. Simpler invertebrates, such as flatworms and annelids, find their food by taste and smell. They only have rudimentary eye spots, sensitive to light and dark. Arthropods and mollusks have well-developed nervous systems that coordinate their movements. Fast-moving animals usually have good vision. Cephalopods have highly developed eyes, rather like those of mammals. Arthropods have compound eyes. Each eye is composed of hundreds of tiny facets, each one of which has its own lens and optical system. Each lens sees only part of the picture. Viewed through arthropod eyes, the picture's not too clear, but the slightest movement is very easy to detect. Invertebrates reproduce in many ways. Some are hermaphrodites. Each animal has both male and female organs. Each hydra produces ovaries near its base and testes near its tentacles. The sperms are shed into the water and swim to find the ovaries of another hydra. Snails and slugs are also hermaphrodite. Fertilization is internal, so two animals participate. Earthworms lie head to tail to mate. The ovaries and testes are in segments some way behind the head. Sperms are exchanged, then stored in special sperm sacs. A few days later, the clitellum, or saddle, secretes a mucus ring, which the worm then slides forward along its body. Eggs and sperms enter the ring as it moves, and fertilization takes place. Eventually, the ring passes off the worm and closes to form a cocoon. Young earthworms hatch from the cocoon. Most invertebrates have separate sexes. External fertilization is common in animals which live in water, especially sedentary or slow-moving ones. Starfish and many bivalves shed their eggs and sperm into the water. Some aquatic invertebrates use internal fertilization, which is less wasteful of sperm and eggs. Barnacles, which can't move around to find a mate, use a penis to inseminate their neighbours. The male crab uses a special appendage on his abdomen to transfer to the female a packet of sperm called a spermatophore. The fertilized eggs develop, protected by the curve of her abdomen. Eventually, they hatch into tiny swimming larvae. In lobsters and crayfish, the eggs are fixed to hairs on the female's swimmerettes, the small paddle-like appendages on her abdomen, where they're carried until hatching. Male insects have a muscular tube-like penis and a pair of claspers for gripping the female. Many invertebrates have young, or larvae, which look different from the adults. Many marine invertebrates produce tiny transparent larvae that drift in the plankton. For slow-moving or sedentary animals like starfish, crabs, and bivalve mollusks, these larvae provide a means of dispersal. Insects also have larvae. Butterfly eggs hatch into caterpillars. These have simple bodies, well suited to a life of almost non-stop eating. When the caterpillar is fully grown, it enters a resting stage. The pupa is protected by a hard outer shell and anchored firmly by a silk pad. Inside the pupa, or chrysalis, the caterpillar's tissues are broken down and rearranged to form an adult butterfly. When this transformation is complete, the pupal case splits and the butterfly emerges. This sequence of bodily changes is called complete metamorphosis. The winged adult is well suited to travel in search of a mate. Some insects undergo incomplete metamorphosis, changing form gradually at each molt. Cockroaches and locusts take several molts to grow their wings. These young, which look rather like miniature adults, are called nymphs. Some coelenterates also change form during the life cycle. Certain polyps in the colony bud off medusae, which swim away. Sexual organs on the medusae shed sperms and eggs into the water. The fertilized eggs hatch into larvae. These will settle on the seabed and develop into polyps. Some invertebrates reproduce asexually. Hydras and some sea anemones produce new individuals by budding. Flatworms reproduce asexually by dividing in two. Each piece regenerates the remainder of the body. Some sea anemones also divide in two. Starfish and spiders can regenerate limbs lost to predators. Leaving a limb behind may be the only way to escape. Water fleas reproduce very rapidly from unfertilized eggs. This is called parthenogenesis. The eggs are kept in a brood pouch under the carapace while they develop. In summer, aphids give birth to young from unfertilized eggs. A single female aphid can produce 25 daughters a day. Each one matures within a week. Invertebrates live in almost all parts of the globe and play important roles in every kind of living community. Burrowing earthworms mix up soil layers, letting air into the soil. This allows decomposer animals to breathe. The leaves worms drag into their burrows decay and return mineral nutrients to the soil. An average hectare of soil may contain 4.5 million earthworms, which move about 27 metric tons of soil a year. Burying beetles drag corpses into the ground where they decay and release nutrients. Dung beetles collect dung and bury it, an even better fertilizer. Vast armies of fly maggots break down the soft flesh of corpses. Beetles and their larvae tunnel in fallen tree trunks, helping to rot the wood. Some invertebrates destroy our crops. Roundworms damage roots and leaves and spoil fruit and vegetables. While worms attack from the inside, aphids feed from the outside, sucking plant juices, transmitting diseases, and weakening the plants. Locusts destroy entire crops. Beetles and their larvae spoil stored grain. Cockroaches invade kitchens to feed on scraps, tainting food with their droppings. Clothes moth larvae chew at our garments, and beetle larvae make holes in our carpets. In the warmer parts of the world, termites cause immense damage to buildings by eating through timbers until they collapse. Invertebrates also live inside humans and other animals. Parasitic worms infect millions of people, especially in the tropics. Roundworms cause hookworm, filariasis, and river blindness. Some invertebrates carry disease to us. Mosquitoes inject yellow fever and malaria. Tsetse flies carry sleeping sickness. And water snails are hosts to the flukes that cause bilharzia. Invertebrates are also food for larger animals. Shrimp are harvested by the ton. Lobsters and crabs are much relished. And mussels and oysters are farmed in estuaries and shallow coastal waters. Bees pollinate our crops. Without them, many flowers would not produce fruits. Bees also produce honey and wax. Tiny floating crustaceans and the larvae of other invertebrates are part of the plankton, a drifting community of animals and plants that forms the base of the ocean food chain. Among the invertebrates, diversity is the keynote. Animals without backbones make up most of the animal kingdom. They include members of every phylum. There may be a million kinds or more. In both form and function, they demonstrate a million different ways to be an animal.